Hello and welcome to this video. This is going to be a bit of a downer video because it's going to be a list of cameras that I don't recommend investing in 2024. So this is cameras that I would say are either not worth your time, not worth your money, or cameras that just don't really sort of lead anywhere in terms of sort of investing in a system. And yeah, let's just get started. First off is the Canon AE system. So either the AE1, AE1 program, AV1, AT1 or A1. These cameras are often recommended for people getting into photography, sort of SLR photography for 35mm. However, I see much more of these broken or with problems than any other system generally. The lenses are very good, fairly affordable depending on the lens, but it's a system that I think is more flawed. Just given the age of the cameras, they're starting to break down more frequently and it's getting harder and harder to get parts for them. They weren't built to the highest spec. Again, they were consumer cameras and oftentimes they were sort of really heavily used and abused. You will get ones that work perfectly fine, but I do think that we're going to start seeing more and more faulty AE1s sort of as we go forward. There are people that still can repair them or sort of do have parts for them, but sort of finding those people is getting harder and harder as time goes on. The next camera is one that I see loads of people recommending as well, is the Pentax ME Super, or the ME, sort of the original. Again, I rarely ever see these in working condition. The light meter itself gives you three little lights in the viewfinder, which I think are very, very tiny filament light bulbs. These blow all the time. And then as soon as they blow, you're kind of stuck not really knowing what exposure you're on. The other thing is that they're fully electronic shutters and they seem to just stop working quite often. In the last 9 years that I've worked at the camera shop that I work at, I've hands down probably seen 10 times as many broken ME Supers as I have working ME Supers. And even the working ME Supers, there's normally something wrong with them, whether that's desilvering of the prism or the light seals need replacing, or there's a little bit of corrosion in the battery compartment. Yeah, there's normally something wrong with them, which it doesn't bode well if you're going to be investing in a camera system. Next one that I don't recommend is going to be the Nikon EM. This is a fully electronic camera again, but was designed as sort of a point and shoot SLR really. Had a very budget lens choices for it, which was specifically designed for this system. Again, oftentimes not working. These seem to break down. I think they just weren't built to the same spec as some of the other Nikons. And yeah, it's one that I just wouldn't recommend. The next two are going to be ones that, again, people will find very controversial. So the Olympus OM10. Now, this is a good camera if you can get one working. They normally sell for about £60 to £100, depending on if you get body only or if you get it with a lens. However, this camera is fully electronic, and if anything goes wrong, oftentimes repairers don't have parts for them. Also, if you do want to be getting into more creative film photography, if you want to use manual exposures, you have to get a separate manual adapter, which I think is just a bit gimmicky is probably the wrong word, but it just feels like a bit of a cop-out on Olympus's part when you can get cheaper and more reliable, fully mechanical cameras where you can actually change the shutter speed. Having a camera that, yes, will primarily just be used in auto, but if you want to take control, you have to buy this additional thing. Just, yeah, feels a bit like a cheat, to be honest. The other Olympus that I wouldn't recommend is the Trip 35. So this is the selenium meter around the lens is basically a little bit radioactive, reacts to light, which creates a little electric current for the meter to run. If these aren't covered, or if they haven't been kept in a case or they haven't had a lens cap on, they will continually run and they break down and sort of degrade over time as they're exposed to light. The number of these that are getting sort of, as they get used, essentially, they start breaking down. and once they stop working, you're then stuck with fixed shutter speed, so no variation in shutter speed. And yeah, it's just it's more hassle than it's worth. People market these cameras as for way higher prices than they're worth when they reskin them, when they put the new leather on them. But yeah, it's just something that they will break. They break down. It's not a system that you can invest in because it's a fixed lens system. You can keep buying Trip 35s, but they will all break. And it's, yeah, one that people seem to be sort of drawn to for some reason. And although they're good cameras when they work, they always break down and there's nothing you can do about it. The last one that I'm going to talk about is going to be most of the Russian cameras. So any camera made by a Russian company, yeah, anything that says USSR or GDR on it, I would normally avoid, just because I've seen loads of cameras that you'll get some that are really, really good and some that are just dead dogs. And that's going to be because the quality control in the Russian factories was really horrific. Like, you literally get if one that came off the production line that works perfectly fine, and then the one that came off the production line after it will be dead. They also have some weird like loading practices or unloading practices on mostly the Zenits. They're a nice cheap way to get into interchangeable lens film photography. However, yeah, you end up normally having to replace the body fairly frequently if you get a dodgy one, just because, yeah, they just give up and they weren't built to the highest spec. It's a nice way to sort of build into a lens system if you then want to pick up, say, like a Pentax Spotmatic later. But it's, yeah, it's, they're not worth the risk. Just trust me, they're not worth the risk. I've seen so many people have the cameras break down and they are normally just a faff to get repaired or not even worth it. So yeah, that is my list of cameras that I don't recommend in 2024. And yeah, if you like this video, please feel free to leave a like. If you've got any comments about my list, as I say, this is all my opinion, just from working in a camera shop. But yeah, if you've got anything to add to this list or sort of anything that you think I should have given more credit to, put it down in the comments and we'll have a discussion about it. If you like this video, like it. If you really like this video, then you can subscribe. Hopefully I'll see you in the next video. And yeah, that's pretty much it. Thanks for watching.